goal really is to fill the gaps left by traditional media. So there's been a lot of cutbacks in newsrooms recently, and often the environment and climate desks are just completely decimated. So because a lot of traditional media can't cover environmental issues in depth, that's something we try to help with. We know in every oil spill that there are hundreds, if not thousands, of different chemicals that are released into the air, and none of these are good for you, but it's hard to say for each individual person what levels are safe. After an oil spill, we don't have federal regulations about who should be evacuated and when they should be evacuated and how to assess that. So every time it happens, the local authorities have to use their best judgment in the heat of the moment and figure it out. No one knew how to clean up this oil because it's different from conventional oil. Normally, when you have an oil spill, the oil is light enough to float on the surface of the water, so you can vacuum it off or skim it off, and the EPA knows how to deal with that. What happened here was when the Dilbit spilled, the light chemicals all started to evaporate or they dissolved. And then all you had left over was the bitumen, which was heavy enough to sink to the bottom of the river. And once that happens, you can't really clean it up because you can't see it, so you don't know where it is. And the EPA didn't know it was Dilbit for more than a week because Enbridge didn't tell them, and the Department of Transportation didn't know either. So at the beginning of this spill, the EPA thought, oh, it's 1 million gallons, we can clean it up in 2 months. Now it's been more than 3 years and they're still cleaning it up, and it's cost more than $1 billion.